Anybody want to take a 2-second break here? We're going to get started on the next.
If anybody needs a book, see Warren on the corner.
Anybody need a book here? Books here. Red Hot Seminar Books here.
Yes, no? Is it somewhere? You sure? Give me that book.
We didn't say meetings though.
Okay, meetings are.
Thank you.
I said, you give me that look, my wife is. No, you didn't do that. Why are you so guilty? I don't know.
Oh, okay.
Question?
Sure.
Well, I'll be tired, guys, and I'll pass that for Chase.
Well, I'm running out of time.
Phil Paterno wants.
Dealing right now with the issue.
We're in the middle of the adoption.
So there's a lot of work.
But the maintenance side is still.
Because, so that means that the IFC is still down as well. When you look at the.
We have, in the 2006, there is.
When you retire, you're in Indian times.
But anyway.
Yeah, I'll send Frank an email. Frank an email.
Our UFC, New Jersey, is not changed. We went from the 96 to the 06, and they're telling us they're open by the end of this year. We'll see.
Right.
You get my message?
There's 6 guys coming in, and 4 guys show up, and I need to hire people.
I mean, if there is, we're.
One
Okay, you guys ready?
Ready.
I don't know.
Because there's three on there that page. I got the check January.
Joe, is that the application?
Mark, red light on?
I got cheese.
All right, does everybody have a book? Everybody else have a standing confidence test?
Yeah.
Dot, go see Warren, you're gonna make the one.
Or your town, whatever you want.
What I wanna start with today is, this is a class I've been teaching for about 10 years, so you can imagine. A lot of great information out there, but there was also a lack of information, so hopefully today I can show you where all this information is gonna be at your fingertips. So I have taught this class from Maine to Florida, from Chicago to Texas, and from Seattle to San Diego. And everybody has the same issues nationwide. My best state is New Jersey. I've taught for Kane University, I've taught in Sayreville, Camden, Bergen. Anybody here been in one of my previous classes? 6-hour course of keeping you guys awake in those warm rooms. But the main thing that we're gonna be teaching that's gonna really set things aside, I'm gonna sort of, because this is a 2-hour class, normally this is a 6-hour continuing ed class. I'm gonna shorten it, but what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna start with the first piece of information that everybody nationwide does. So all the gray-haired guys teach the new guys who are fighting fires. In case of fire, don't use the... See that? So one of the reasons why fire escapes have not been maintained is because for 75 years they've ignored them. And it was a lot simpler not to really, you know, get it back on track, start inspecting them. They basically said, you know what? Let's protect our guys, and in case of fire, don't use the...
Fire escapes.
You can say it. So what happened, something dropped there. And these fire escapes, don't forget, was something that was built in the 1900s to basically say, hey, firemen need a way to get into a building and people to get themselves out of a building. So if you're not using the fire escape, why don't we have a news piece that goes out and says, everybody who owns a house, in case you have a fire, don't use your fire escape. Because it'll probably kill you. Because we already know, we're coming there to fight the fire. We already know not to use the fire escape. So there's something must have happened. And what it was is that fire escapes built in the 1900s were built super strong. A properly maintained fire escape will never, ever kill anybody. It's proven. So let's take the, you know why they built it at 100 pounds per square foot? Because it's a ridiculous number. So let's take a look at these guys. This is a 5x5 platform plus minus. Enough firemen on there? If each fireman weighed 300 pounds with their gear on, right? So 5x5 is 25 foot square times 100 pounds, 2,500 pounds. But that was designed, built, and has been holding for the day it was put in. Through the building, cemented or with a through bolt, 2,500 pounds. So 300 pound firemen weigh how much? So still an extra 1,000 pounds there. But you can't fit them. So here's something that was built that you can't even put enough people on there. Let's take 150 pound tenants. What's 10 150 pound tenants? Wait. And can you get 10 people in a 5x5?
No.
So these fire escapes were built beyond what was ever normal. So they said, here's the number. They should be built at 50 pounds per square foot. They built at 100. So everybody, we've done the calcs on this through the National Fire Escape Association. You have to be 2 feet square, 10 feet tall. Over 600 to 700 pounds a person in order to just to equal the square footage requirement there. So what happened? When they first built them out of very strong steel, very strong connections into the building, and all of a sudden, maintenance. That's all that happened. Fire escapes and the fire escape steel didn't fail. The source is at its connections. Once a connection fails, I don't care how much of a steel angle you have, a C channel you got, it's gonna fall. We're also going to talk about welding today, and that every one of these fire escapes is made with a bolt or a rivet. There's no welds. There's a few fire escapes out there welded, but there's no welding on fire escapes. Because welds snap, bolts stretch. So a welded connection next to a bolted connection over a period of time, that bolted connection will scream for 15 years with rust inside of it, trying to hold on. Anybody here do welding? No? Well, you can ask any welding company out there that as soon as you introduce rust jacking or ice jacking into a welded connection, guess what happens to that weld? It'll resist 70,000 pounds of force. And how much force does ice or rust jacking have? More than that. And what's it do? Snaps. What happens to you when you step on it? Fall. But yet, one of the reasons why a lot of fire escapes today haven't been falling is because you guys are stepping on bolted, riveted connections that have a huge amount of rust in it. They're all V'd out or whatever. But what's in there holding it still? That bolt is it's being eaten and trying to be torn apart. But if that's welded, or the repair is a weld, which we're going to go heavily into weld today to say it's not a standard repair. It's a Band-Aid. It's a Band-Aid for cancer. But it doesn't cure the source, right? So this is what we're going to tell you today. Fire escapes today, 95% of every fire escape that I look at today can still be fixed. So today is not a thing that says, hey, let's go and replace these fire escapes with new galvanized. They're full of lead, as you know, but this is not a replacement. It's just to tell you that the steel is thick, the connections are strong, the fasteners are garbage. But they've been around for 75 years. Okay? We also have a confidence test in front of you. So today I'm going to go a little bit into some of the stories that are happening nationwide, and then what I'm going to do is I'm going to open up the questions. So before I go into a class, I want to sort of let everybody just have any question. You can stump me on a question, and I want to be able to say, that's a great question, this is where you find it on the internet. That's a great question, this is where you find it on the internet. So to say that I'm not the one that has the information is available out there, but now that you know where it is, you can start writing violations. Now here's a great one. Yeah, the violations you basically write because a fire escape is suspect, right? How many people have wrote a violation in the past 3 months on a fire escape? And the reason why? Because a lot of times you write a violation, and then the client comes back, I'm trying to find somebody to fix it, and I can't find anybody, so what happens? You stop writing violations. Stop telling your men to do what when it comes to a fire? Don't get on it. So there's plenty of people out there that can fix fire escapes. They already live in your community, so architects and engineers can inspect these things. They just need some guidance. That's why we have a confidence test for you to use with your own people locally. Local ornamental iron workers and welding guys. Yes, welding guys can't fix a fire escape. They just need to shut off their welding machine. Because if they're using the welding machine, weren't they supposed to sign a permit with you, a fire permit? Weren't they supposed to have a fire watch with you? We lost two firemen up in Boston because the guy was welding on a fire escape. So welding is not an acceptable means of repair. It's an acceptable means of emergency repair, but it's not a standard repair because most of these guys will weld rust right in the connection. So we'll talk about that, but this is why you're looking at it. Only two people have written, and they're from the same city. Are you guys looking part-time and write violations in other cities? Can you guys do that? They need you guys to come.
Yeah.
Right, so don't forget, these fire escapes have been bad. A lot of them haven't seen a certification in 25, some in 50, and some in 75 years. Now, one of the reasons why I know so much about fire escapes is I'm also an expert witness. And I've been an expert witness for firefighters. One that, it was New York City, fell through two sets of stairs, injured, he was 27 years old, got permanently disabled. I do death, I do injury, and they bring me in, and the main thing that they bring me in for is to say, what happened? And it's always lack of maintenance. But back then, the reason why these guys were all crawling all over, you know why? These fire escapes were only 25 years old now, on average. They were built solid, and they felt confident on there because people could self-evacuate. You need elephants not to get on this. There's no room with this. Look at how many people are on here, and they're all nice and confident. Today, you wouldn't find that in today's firefighters. I noticed your tower over here has some fire escapes. You know how many towers I inspect nationwide that they failed on the tower? You got a nice new galvanized one here. But if it was brown, I would be out there, and I'd be looking at it, because even your own fire escape, and I've shut down towers while I'm teaching a class. And I use my tapping hammer. I go in and start tapping, and these treads are falling. And I'm like, guys, what are you training on how to get hurt too? Is that what this is all about over here? So let's go fast track. Let's stop after the video. Then I want to open up to questions. See what kind of questions you have. What do you know about fire escapes? What do you don't know about fire escapes? And then we'll get back to the slides. All right, let's open up your book. If you take a look at your book on the inside, tags. There's a couple of cities that are already mandatory. And if you look in your fire code, all fire protection equipment in your fire code, they need a tag. Yeah? Well, fire escapes for fire protection, gift that they never had in their entire lives. A tag. This red one says, don't use it. It helps the firemen and the people who live there not use the fire escape. See this yellow one, it says it's under repair. You see this white one, it says it's good. Does it also tell you when the next inspection date is, or you have to go back to your office? So this is a tag. This is the size of a tag. You want to pass this around? Just keep moving it around. There's a red and the yellow. It's a combo. These tags, who uses them right now? Seattle uses them. They want theirs 11 by 19, permanently affixed to a fire escape 7 to 10 feet off the ground, so that the firemen, when they get there, what do they say so that they don't have to worry about whether or not they're going to use the fire escape? What color they want to see? A white tag. If all of a sudden they see a yellow and a red, do they have justification not to climb that thing and get themselves hurt? So you need some sort of signal. That's what these tags are. Portland, Oregon. I've been doing this for 10 years. You know what the only state that's adopted this into their state, this program into their state? Portland, Oregon. I've played all the shows, but you know the state that did something about it? Portland, Oregon, the number one state. Next to New Jersey, Portland already went in and put these programs in play. We have department procedures and guidelines. A lot of times people don't know what to do. We have these ready for you. You can use it. It's a Word document, it's a PDF. Take all our information out, put your information in, put your code in, or you can just copy the words, drop it, it's not copyrighted. Just use it. Okay. If you go online, okay, and you type in fire escape issues, Portland, Oregon, they have the whole system online for you, ready to go. Everything. You know what they also have? This is their entire fire protection program online. You want to steal some nice sprinkler system testing? You want to steal some good guidelines here and there? Everything in fire protection is here. So write it down. Fire escape issues, Portland, Oregon. You can just copy and paste. It's a good system. It's already there. And they've adopted our system on the proper inspection confidence test. Another one is Reg 4, Los Angeles. Reg 4 is all protected under Regulation 4 in the city of Los Angeles. Everything fire protection is controlled through them. And guess how much they charge me to get my license every 3 years from them? $1,000. Guess what kind of test I have to give to go through the 100 questions? I have to get at least an 80. And I got to walk out with the fire marshal in the building, the fire marshal, and I have to go and prove that I can inspect the fire escape. So I can get a fire escape assemblies tester. And every 3 years they ask me for your new contribution of 50% of my original. So if you want a copy, it's already online, Reg 4. Reg4.org or LAReg4.org. Los Angeles, go steal, go copy. It's all there. Somebody else has already done all the work. Confidence test. First time I got called to do a confidence test, there wasn't one. So I got pulled out to Seattle, and Seattle says, listen, four guys just fell almost to their death. What we need is this, and we need that, and we started there. And that's where we started with confidence tests, and now we've taken it nationwide. But Seattle was the first one to bring me in. And usually after an injury of some kind. So we're doing it, we be proactive, or we can wait for a fatality to occur, which happens all the time. And sometimes you guys are aware of firemen. How many here are aware of a fireman that got hurt on a fire escape in their past history, past 10, 15 years? No? A lot of firemen get injured on fire escapes. A lot. This confidence test, which we're going to go over, is 25 questions. Those 25 questions cover every aspect of a fire escape. And you know who has to sign that? Structural engineer, registered architect, or others acceptable to the building official with specific expertise in fire escapes. Right? It's under your code. So If not, if they don't fill out this yes, no questionnaire, guess what they've been giving you? An opinion affidavit, which states, to the best of my information, knowledge, and belief, this fire escape is ready for its intended use, which is a golden parachute for who? For you or for the guy signing that? So he collects his check downstairs. Does he have to go up the stairs anymore?
No.
He looks up. As long as none of it is on the ground, what's he say? Looks good. And the only time you know it's no good is when one of your guys is on the ground. From what? A rail that let go that he never saw. This is a checklist questionnaire. They will not want to sign this because they will come back and say, no, I don't want, I can't be that specific. You say, well, didn't you walk the fire escape? You know, I just looked at it. Got none. I want you to walk it. I ain't walking that thing. Exactly. Fill out the form. Tell your client that it's so bad you won't even walk it. Because my guys need to know, and so do my tenants in the tenants in the building, they need to know, and I want a tag on that thing. Is that thing a red, a yellow? And a red is, this piece is dangling. A yellow, there's almost pieces dangling. You know what I'm saying? That means it needs general routine maintenance. A white means that the fire escape is certified. Already in use in certain states. Massachusetts, we've got that conference that you have there, maybe the one from Lowell. That's a model city. Now, this is not going to happen overnight. It took 75 years for us to screw this up. They're ready for the long haul, 3 to 5 years. And what we're going to be talking about today is putting it on a checklist. You're not going to start a team. You're not going to start, put together a squad or a task force. You're just going to tie this confidence test to things you already do on your building. Smoke detector sign-off. Guess what you ask for upon completion of a smoke detector sign-off and they're ready to occupy the building. I need a copy of your fire escape affidavit. You're not ordering one. You're asking for one. They don't have one. Do you stop them from occupying? No. Fill it. Now they got 30 days to get the fire escape affidavit. Pulling a building permit at the city. They've got everything. You know, the plans, the architectural stamp, the check for the, you know, for the application, everything. What do you ask? You have a copy of a confidence check for your fire escape. Why? Because OSHA 1910 requires that during any renovations and repairs, you have 2 means of egress that are certified. So you fix the fire escape first or last during renovations. Based on OSHA. Fix it first. Do you stop the permit process? No. Say, hey, here you go, let's get going. But I'm going to stop by and see the situation because if the fire escape is in bad repair, I'm going to order some scaffolding so you can continue with your construction. But I want you to mothball the fire escape for my men and for the people and for all the workers inside the building. Okay? So we're going to go over all that today. Now, does anybody remember the station night fire? Mm-hmm. Many years ago? Channel 7, one of an investigative news reporters, she came out. She said, hey, I want to do a class on fire escapes and show how great fire escapes are and that these people who died in the station night fire, but, you know, for people who live in homes, in case you got to make sure all your exits are good. I told her, the exits are bad. She didn't want to believe me. I told her that. Majority of the fire escapes that I inspect, over 75% of everything I inspect does not pass. And of that, over 50% has life safety concerns everywhere in the U.S. The worst, Philadelphia. Second worst, New York City. Not too far behind? Anybody close to New York City? Anything by the water, bad, okay? So let's take a look at, she wanted to do a 1 minute piece on the fire escape. She ended up doing this.
State officials didn't know the system they set up to keep fire escapes safe is also falling apart.
The potential ramifications are disastrous.
So let's look at this one. This expert ironworker is licensed to build, maintain, and inspect fire escapes.
So they're all repaired?
For months, we examined dozens of them with alarming results.
Looking at this today, would this pass inspection?
No.
In dormitories, at theaters, at homes, and apartment buildings.
Rust is actually eating away the metal of the fire escape.
Right.
And the bottom line?
It'll get weak and then eventually it'll fall.
This one has rotted connections. This one, missing bolts, twisted metal.
Would the stairs come down?
No, never come down.
This one, a broken tread.
So how dangerous is it for the people inside this building?
This fire escape is definitely going to put somebody either in the hospital or it's going to put somebody in a cemetery.
Fire escapes are so critical. The state building code requires they be certified for structural adequacy and safety every 5 years. But our investigation found that safeguard is simply being ignored. Here's proof. We chose fire escapes at random in Boston, Somerville, Cambridge, Worcester, and here in Quincy. We checked building department files.
But there's no fire escape certification.
To see if building owners had submitted their mandatory inspection reports.
There's no certification in this one either.
Bottom line, not one we checked in Quincy had been certified as safe. And the Director of Inspectional Services admitted because of staffing shortages, the city has no idea how many other fire escape owners are breaking the rules.
And as a result, do you know how many fire escapes in your city are safe or not?
Well, I don't know.
In Worcester, not one we checked was certified. In Somerville, four more fire escapes.
Do they fall through the cracks?
Not one up-to-date certification. And again, no system for keeping track.
How can I get away?
I guess the shortest answer of all is because we don't have the resources to sit here and follow up on these things.
If structural deficiencies are reported, local building inspectors can actually evacuate residents until repairs are made.
Would you talk to us on camera about this?
No. But when we surveyed 24 more communities, most admitted they had no idea how many fire escapes were certified. In Taunton, inspectors told us they haven't seen a certification in 25 years. Northampton officials said, it's a cold day in hell when that happens. In Cambridge, too, not one of our test buildings was certified, and the official in charge would not come out to discuss it. In Boston, where there are more than 8,000 fire escapes, again, according to inspectional services, not one we checked was certified. Officials know they are required to enforce the building code, but they admit they don't always know if owners are breaking the law.
The building code is being ignored.
Right, but it's difficult to write a violation if you don't have knowledge of something like that.
But state officials say for a critical issue like this, communities should know. And they warn, the Massachusetts building code is not optional.
Does it worry you that these fire escapes are not being certified?
This is an important issue and should not be ignored.
That's because after the smoke and flames begin, it'll be too late to learn you've got no way out.
I can't stress it enough, Hank, that these things have to be maintained and someone's got to be watching.
As a result of our investigation, state officials will now issue an alert to local inspectors. Meanwhile, if there's a fire escape on your home or office, you can contact your local building department to make sure it's properly certified. In the newsroom, I'm Hank Phillippe Wright.
Keith.
So we got a problem.
Yeah.
You have a problem. We have a 5-year rule, and it happened. Turn the book around. The book that we have. Turn on the look on the back page. That's why our code went to 5-year, because prior to that, it's maintained at all times. So it took in 1973, and this is 2003 when I did this. We're in 2017. You guys can imagine it doesn't move very quickly, but. Because of that the fireman saved himself with one hand. The woman died. The niece landed on her 40 feet. This is what happens. This is the fireman's worst nightmare. When you're out there saving somebody and you get killed by the very thing that's supposed to be saving you. So it's at the critical point. She's ready to go. You guys have the green card rule here. There's your 5-year rule. Otherwise, when you adopt the 2012 and the 2015, guess what it says in the International Fire Code? All fire escapes must be examined every. But in the meantime, while you're waiting for it, you have your green card. And that's the entire structure, right? So what should you be asking for as part of your 5-year that the state goes through? Make sure that the state is asking for the 5-year certificate. So you already have it. You can throw it in there. and ask for your 5-year certificate. But the key here is going to be adding it to a checklist. So fire department's going to have a checklist, building department's going to have a checklist tied to its permits, and then I'm going to go into some examples. Let's go to a couple other sad scenarios nationwide. All right, so you guys understand that this is why it usually takes somebody dying for things to happen, then things cool off. Everybody understands that in Oakland, only 38 people died, right? So this is what happened. This is the worst case scenario. You know, you're saving somebody and you can only use the fire escape for whatever reason. Somebody gets hurt, somebody dies. Firemen, they're supposed to be going through this thing, but they're second guessing themselves. Your fireman second guesses himself, what happens? Dies. People out looking at a parade, what happens? On a fire escape that's never been certified for 50 to 75 years. Dies. One of my guys, his father was 57 years old on a 7th story working. This is not him, but this is, you know, guess what happened at a fire escape? Collapsed. Dies. Remember one of the days when, before air conditioning, where did you sleep? And why did you sleep there? Because they were safe. Because they were only 25 to 50 years old. They would never fall apart. So, there's a human load testing going on right now. I'm trying to see if I can get a pilot going where people cheat on themselves through the fire escape, but you know, it would be a deadly situation, so. But this is what's happening. You know, people are using fire escape. And no smoking policy, what's that mean? Where people go? Fire escape. That's the smoking room, that's the new smoking room, right? It's right up the street from you guys.
But right now, firefighters are taking down the ladders and rolling up the hoses. But earlier in the night, when they pulled up, there were flames coming out of the side of the building. Firefighters say it was one of the scarier moments because when you pull up to a building and you see children and mothers hanging off the side of the fire escape, smoke swirling around them, they said that's scary, scary stuff. They got up there, they got the ladders up, and they said nobody got hurt.
The fire escape, there was 3 or 4 people hanging off the fire escape. They couldn't get off. They were just on the fire escapes. I had people hanging in the fire escapes at the rear of the building, and on this side of the building, we had a bunch of people on that fire escape.
But about 50 people were displaced inside this building. Our firefighters say there's good news tonight. It looks like everybody will be allowed to go back in, except the one unit where the fire was in. They said, that's good luck to them tonight. I'm Bob Wilson, on the scene of Bridgeport, News 8.
I went there 6 months later. 50 units, right? Every fire escape failed. Those life safety concerns everywhere. And you see what he said there? When they got there, people are on the fire escape. Fire escapes for what use? Self-evacuation. What do you mean, trap? So is he fighting a fire when he got there, or was he just a rescue mission? Rescue mission that took how many minutes? Doesn't matter, because how many people can die during those precious few minutes? Fire doesn't kill you, the smoke does. And why? So here he is, talking about the entire building. He kept saying, people are on the fire escape, we have to get them off. People are on the fire escape, we have to get them off. And that's what's gonna happen. You're gonna be getting to fire escape where the ladder doesn't come down. You saw that 8-year-old child, 12 feet above the ground. Who taught her how to climb down a ladder? And the firemen are down below telling him to do what? Jump, and what's she gonna do? Unless there's a trampoline down there, you know, that'll look like fun. And that's where people get hurt.
Witnesses say it sounded like an incredible explosion when the fire escape of a Philadelphia apartment building suddenly collapsed and injured 3 people.
NBC 10 cameras were there as a friend holds on to one of the victim's hands, who is apparently conscious as the victim is placed into an ambulance by medics.
KYW-TV reports a man who was critically injured and 2 women were rushed to local hospitals.
Police believe the bolts of the fire escape appear to have been rusted and dislodged from the brick wall of the apartment building.
The victims fell more than 30 feet to the ground, and now the incident is under investigation. Worth noting, the complex is more than 100 years old, and even on Philadelphia's historic registry. Local reporters are all pointing out the city's licenses and inspections department hasn't filed any violations in the past when it comes to the old building, so Sunday's collapse came without warning. Neighbors say that 3 victims, reportedly all in their 20s, may have been partying at the fire escape landing before the incident. For Newsy, I'm Elizabeth Hagedorn.
See that? May have been partying. From my first picture, how many kids could they have brought into that fire escape from inside the party onto that fire escape if it was maintained properly?
Probably the whole party.
They could bring the whole party out there. So is there any reason why people can or cannot get on fire escapes if it's related to safety? There isn't. Now, I was called in as an expert witness and that kid that went, he died. The other two girls were, they fell almost 40 feet, main, horrifically. I happened to be in that area, and this is the other piece. I taught a class to over 50 LNI in Philadelphia, to their Liberty chapter, just 6 months before. And I told them it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. What happened? Mm-hmm. Since then, I've been calling and speaking, and I've been to some of their meetings, and do you think they've called me back? So a lot of times these things become something that you want to deal with, or something you just, you know, rebury your head in the sand with it. But that the case just recently settled, and a lot of it was because the Farscape was proved in our testimony that the through bolts gave out just got eaten away. Okay.
Farscape engineers inspect the summary video here in Philadelphia. All right, some of the preliminary information that I'm getting out of this is that this piece here...
2 days after the fact, so it's nothing to do with the case.
This is the fact, it should be up against the building. These two brackets here, used to be going to that fourth, fifth floor up there, where you now see the two blowouts. The blowout on the left and the blowout on the right.
That's where the through bolts went into the building.
And it used to be attached there.
Well, I got in there,
and
ate it.
This staircase, which is here, it went to that platform up there. And that platform up there also had a bracket which is now laying inside the floor below. So,
not good. This is another case I was involved in. The guy was selling this as condos, and he and his son did the roof, took the Farscape apart, put the Farscape back together, had some extra bolts in the box. Like any good man mechanic, what do you do with those extra bolts? Put in the drawer, because you're going to need that for the next rebuild, right? They all got on it, and the fire escape slid off the roof, onto the roof below, thank God, instead of all the way to the ground. About five people were underneath there, mangled. Each one had a cell phone. First thing you do with a cell phone, you dial. No, you call your lawyer. Your lawyer called that. There's another one.
I was just walking up the street to get to the bus stop, and the cops were right there, told me I couldn't come this way.
Police say the victim and several others were working on the roof of this privately owned building when the man fell.
He may have fallen a distance of anywhere from 15 to 20 feet is what's being investigated right now.
Tragically, the man died on scene. It's believed he fell from the fire escape and not the roof or a window, although how it happened is still unknown.
That's what's being investigated right now to determine the actual cause of the accident itself.
Right now, police say the death is not criminal and is being called an industrial accident.
There were several witnesses, individuals who were working with the deceased party, and so we've interviewed them as witnesses in this investigation.
It's really sad. I feel bad for his family. I mean, I don't know him, but prayers and best wishes to his family.
Others in the area expressing similar concerns and well wishes, visibly distraught by the day's events.
I mean, I can't even imagine it just coming out to do your job one day, just fall off of the building. Like, it's really sad.
So what occurred there, this is a cantilevered system with a weight on the nose, mm-hmm. on the cable. And it was frozen. So the first guy went out as far as he could and wouldn't go down. He asked him with his buddies to come out. Went out as far as they could. Finally let go. And the cable whipped in. Oof. So a lot of times you survive a little longer from 10 to 15 foot drop. This one. We got called by the OSHA on that one. There's another one in Boston. This building's on a hill. This building's a five-story, but this five-story oversees the deck. They have a brand new deck on this side. So what happens, they would go over in the middle of the night, some young kids. So a young guy and his girlfriend went over there, the phone rang, she came back, and because the rail was missing, she came down and fell. Missing pieces of a fire escape. There's another case I was involved in Iowa. Students watching fireworks. The guys came in here and did that to fix a window, fix some siding. So the workers took the fire escape off, fixed it, put it back in, not with through bolts, but with lag bolts. There's the smoking gun.
Jesus.
So after they got injured, they fell. Well, this is the piece that was up there. This is us 8 blocks away in a field. So this is fire escape CSI.
This looks like a leg for the snitching.
So they were supposed to keep this in a controlled area and follow it in a field. But then we found the bolts and found the smoking gun.
Hold on a second.
Right.
Please.
Can we, gentlemen?
You know, when they say gentlemen, there's a lot of lawyers and a lot of people in the same in the same field. That's because they found out that their workers put the lag bolt back, a half inch lag bolt back in a half inch hole. So this is what it looked like. So now they basically put the thing back on, threw bolt it back in like it was supposed to, put a leg on it onto the roof, the asphalt shingle roof, with a sleeper or right up the shingles. Right on the shingles, so, and then there was no legs here before. Onto the sleepers or onto the shingles? Right onto the shingles, so she's not going anywhere now. She really didn't need all this extra. She didn't need, the belt didn't need suspenders, you know what I'm saying? So this through bolt here was all it needed. And a couple of legs here, didn't need this.
Okay,
so now, proper installation of fire escapes.
Denison Street.
Let's find out who inspects fire escapes. Engineers. Architects. Everybody's telling me you guys are inspecting fire escapes. Because a lot of times when you walk out of a building, this is what you got to write. You are writing scrape and paint violations that were written exactly the same way in 1900 and 1920 and 1940. Every fire official and building official will walk up to a fire escape and say, I need you to scrape and paint it. And you write the same violation today. What you're supposed to write, and you should write this down, inspect it, repair it, test it. Don't write scrape and paint. Inspect it, which is what the code says. Inspect it, repair it, test it. If they don't need any repair, they go right from inspection right to test it. If you want to load test a 50, 75, 100-year-old structure, I'm going to tell you where to go to get this information, okay? If you want an opinion affidavit golden parachute, it's going to state very clearly on the document, to the best of my information, knowledge, and belief, the fire escape is in conformity with the New Jersey Building Code and ready for its intended use, which puts all the liability back on who? On the owner of the building, right? Is it that day test? What happens if tomorrow broken? Then call me tomorrow. I'll look at it again. So it's the goal, it's the walk away. You accept it as a document, even though your document on the you probably use 1028.3, right? 1028.3 says, depending on the condition, a load test may be ordered. So, where's the load test on these 50, 75, 100-year-old structures? Nobody's doing load tests. What is a load test? Yeah, I gotta show you where it is, right? Let's see who else is on here. And then we're gonna open up the questions before I get back to the slides, okay? Fire escape inspectors. What are those people? Well, you have the others acceptable to the building official, right? There's a code, there's an actual code for others acceptable to the building official, because we have new things coming out now. Solar. We have new things coming out now that are dealing with all kinds of new technology, and architects and engineers today don't even know anything about it. So what is it required? This other allows you to bring in somebody that has a specialty in that field, whatever it may be, and in all cases, you still have the right to ask for an architectural or a structural engineer stamp above and beyond that person, okay? Write in the code. The International Fire Code. Building Code, I'm gonna see if I also have the NFPA. So, the 2012 testing and certification, all exterior fire escapes shall be examined and or tested. And or certified. What have we been getting for the past 50 to 75 years? Testing or certifications, which are our opinion affidavits? What's everybody been getting?
Nothing.
Opinion affidavits. Opinion affidavits. So it's right here. Let's talk about the International Building Code. Any fire escape system found to be in a state of deterioration or unsafe shall be repaired immediately, depending upon the structural condition, a load test shall be conducted. This is your 1028.3, New Jersey. 1028.3, this is what exactly your code says. NFPA, the authority having jurisdiction shall be permitted to approve any existing fire escape that has been shown by load test or other satisfactory evidence. What's that mean? If you compare that to this, what's that mean? Well, that means that the first thing you want from every fire escape you get, now that they're all 50, 75 plus years old, what's the first thing you always want? A load test, right? Otherwise, give me other satisfactory evidence. What would be other satisfactory evidence? An opinion affidavit from somebody who doesn't get out of the car? An opinion affidavit from somebody who doesn't walk the fire escape? Or somebody that can prove to you that the whole entire fire escape system, all the fasteners were all changed out? That the guy then verified that connection into the building, he verified it into the building, or he put a new connection? Is that other evidence of strength? So that's what we're going to be talking about today. The IBC, all exterior fire escapes, shot systems shall be examined and or tested and or certified. What do you think people have been using for 50 to 75 years? This certification has taken off like wildfire because it's easy. Engineers and architects, it's called a drive-by shooting. Stamp fours. How much can you make by lowering your window? Enough to get power windows for the next time you come out, because that's all you do. You look at the fire escape, you sign that piece of paper, you guys take it, stick it in your jacket, and what happened? That kind of abuse for 50 to 75 years, now you are telling your men, because of what happened on this drop of the maintenance code, you're telling your men to use or not use the fire escapes. Okay, so now let's open it up. If anybody wants to write down fireescapesnj.com.
With the through bolts.
Yep, I'm gonna go right here.
Is there a regulation on what the through bolts have to go through?
So this is the point now. Any question you have on a fire escape, so let me tell you, I got hijacked at this by my dad when I was in 1971. So I've been at this since 11 years old. I got 40 plus, 50 years plus on this. I'm actually only 6 years old. But that's how long I've been in it. So I've worked it, I've painted them, I've done it right, I've done it wrong, and I'm the founder of the National Fire Escape Association. So all through bolts are either minimum of 5/8 or 3/4. They go through the building, and they have a plate on the inside, and it's a sandwich, and it goes to the outside. So what's your question on the through bolts? Who has the question on the through bolts?
It has to go through a header system and a steel plate, or what's...
No, the only ones that really get complicated on through bolts is California. They want you to go back and pick up a joist. It's a lot of seismic issues, but basically you make a sandwich on a wall. And a lot of times it's two studs, right? You got two studs, put some blocking, put your through bolt through here. Your plate is on the inside, usually a 4x8 or a 5x10 by half inch thick plate. It picks, and then the through bolt goes outside, and on the outside you just screw it onto a piece of angle. And this picks up two studs. Every now and then they try to put a three quarter or a 5/8 rod through a stud. Guess what happens when you drill through a stud? And they pick up one stud, they just drill the hole all the way through. Guess what happens? There's no stud there, it's gone. So all through bolts usually involve blocking. You know what I'm saying? You get two 16s, you put in double two by 10s, then you drill your three quarters through, bolt on the outside but plate on the inside, picking up your blocking, toenailed into the 16s. Other questions? Anything related to fire escape, about painting, lead paint, EPA?
It's more of a question for, I guess maybe you're dealing a lot with the 2015 code. Is there anything that you know that's going to require any five-year testing? Because right now in New Jersey, they just say when you go out and if you think it looks bad, right, you have them maintain it, and that's it.
Yeah, no.
I'm not an expert. I mean, I can look and say there's a little rust there, or I see a bolt missing, but I don't know beyond that if it's going to fail if people walk on it.
Sure. I mean, 2012 already says that the fire, it's got to be examined everywhere in the U.S. The IFC 2012 already says the 5 year. You go to the IBC, it says see the IFC. Yeah. So if you're going to the 2015, it's carrying the same. So the 5 year rule is already in the IFC.
As far as I know, New Jersey's carrying that. I can double check that.
Yeah, because right.
The other thing you can do, Keith, is that there's an NFEA standard on fire escape,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So remember, there's a section of the code that says if you don't have another.
If it's silent
code,
or whatever, yeah.
You can use that one. Sorry.
So I'm gonna scroll through. Look, if you guys.
I'll actually answer on 15.
Okay. You guys can type in fireescapesnj.com. That's what this is. Fireescapesnj.com. This is put out by the National Fire Escape Association. I will answer every one of your questions through this page. It's a single page. It's made for people who own homes, architects, engineers, firefighters, building inspectors. This is there for you. Ready? So look, there's all the codes right there. This is the 1028.6. This is your code. The exterior stairs, all exits, exterior stairways and fire escape shall be kept free of snow and ice. Any new fire escape systems to be found in a state of disrepair or the terrain to be unsafe by the fire official shall be repaired immediately. Depending upon the structural condition, a load test of any fire escape shall be conducted before and the fire escape is returned to service in accordance with your code, uniform construction code. So this is where we have all your information. See this technical assistance? This is in the section 103.4.
Yeah.
This is telling you that if all of a sudden you bring in somebody from a fire protection company, somebody from an ironwork company, somebody that has credentials that wants to inspect, you can use somebody if you so wish. Otherwise, your codes, I put all the four codes on here on this page for you. There's the IFC, there's the IBC, there's the NFPA, the authority having jurisdiction shall accept by load test or other evidence of strength. And I also have OSHA. This OSHA 1910.37 is critical. It says that during any alterations and repairs, a fire escape must be maintained in a safe condition. So, you know how many buildings are being repaired right now in your cities that if they don't have a certified fire escape, that could shut down the operation? But as soon as they put scaffolding up, guess what happens? It continues. This is just to make sure that the tenants, the workers, and the firemen that are going to hit that fire escape are going to hit something that's certified. So, see the five steps to certifying a fire escape? It's all on there. It tells you what's the steps. Schedule a pre-load test evaluation by a design professional or others acceptable to the building official. Said professional will confirm with the city official if there is any other requirements other than load testing or other evidence of strength that the city official wants. For example, do you want to witness the exam? Submit an evaluation report to the city official. Pass or fail. You know how many people here have ever received a fail confidence test? You only get the passes, right? Oh, it's good. You never hear about the bad ones because they keep that sort of secret. But the code says that every examination you must get a copy of. Nobody's giving you fails, because a lot of times those fails include life safety concerns. Issue a certification if passed, done by load test or other evidence of strength of the city official. If failed, owner, agent, and city will confirm the next steps. We don't confirm the next steps. You and the owner of the building. Do they need a safety watch? Do they need to shut down the building? Do they need to pull a permit on the job, on the work that's going to be done? And then if they have any questions about what we tell them here, guess what we tell them to do again? Number five. You say, contact your local building official.